Hi guys, welcome back to my project. I'm Eric. This is the final video of the Flutter Mqtt Client App for ESP32 CAM. As you can see here, I attached the ESP32 CAM to my bag and tested it to work as an action camera. Also, it's posting data using my phone's hotspot. This allows you to publish data from ESP32 CAM from anywhere. They are receiving ESP32 CAM images on this MacBook and this Android phone in real time by subscribing to the ESP32 CAM's topic. Okay, I'm ready to go. Let me work around for a while. Because Mqtt Broker is installed on AWS EC2, it can be also accessed from the out-of-local network. ESP32 CAM publishes data to a particular topic one-sided, while other clients only subscribe to it to receive data. Perhaps this is the simplest version of the Mqtt client. It's also possible to subscribe to a specific topic and issue comments to a specific client, or can be two-way communication. If you need to control various sensors, I think it would be ideal to control them using the Mqtt protocol. Of course, we have lots of options to make a communication environment, but HTTP or HTTPS would be too heavy in an IoT environment. I want a better FPS, but this is what we can do with the ESP32 CAM. As long as it has enough battery and a stable network status, we can use it anywhere. If there is a chance, I think it would be good to test it on a device with a SIM module. Following the previous video, we will complete the Mqtt client on the Flutter today. The video is longer than I thought, but I believe this would be helpful for someone who needs this. Please leave your questions in the comments below if you need them. Let's get started. What we have to do from now on is to make Mqtt client. Thanks to this Mqtt client library that supports not only desktop apps, but also mobile apps, it's easy to create. It supports AWS IoT as well as other major cloud providers, making it easy to use. This library supports Mqtt version 3.1 and 3.11. If your Mqtt broker is version 5, you should use different Mqtt client library. Let's add this library to the project. First, project manages all resources as well as the libraries required by the project in the pubspec YAML file. You can easily use it by adding the libraries you need here. After adding the library, run the pubget command to download the library into the project. You can run pubget command on the terminal or click the pubget on the menu above Android Studio. It's downloaded and ready to use. I will create the SS folder into the root of the project and then create a folder called certs. A certificate is required to access the server in the application. What you need to do is that you must bring the certificate and key into the project to access the AWS IoT bridge. You remember that we added these keys to the secrets header file in the ESP32 CAM project. You can download it directly from the server, or you can copy the text and make it into each file. A total of three files are ready, root.ca, device certificate, and private key. Prepare each of them and put them all in folder called certs in assets. Go back to the pubspec YAML file and register all of them to let the application access these files. This will allow you to read all of these files from your code. It's time to write the code for Mqtt client connections. I'm making the function called Mqtt connect. Use the keyword future to make it behave asynchronously. Typically, most of the operations that work with the server work asynchronously. The return type is used as a bool so that you can know if the connection is successful. One string will be included as a parameter. The string is a client ID received from the user. The reason for using the async keyword is that there is a code that also works asynchronously within this function. There must be a return, so I'll put any value in first. Another function to create is to update the status text. When you call setState, it reloads the screen so the status text in the footer below layout changes to new text. Updates the status text when the connection starts. I will read the files inside the project in byte format. An object in a Flutter service called the root bundle can read files inside the project. Make sure that the path to the file is correct. Read all three files the same way. A security context is an object in the Dart IO and can contain the certificates to trust when making a secure client connection, and the certificate chain and private key to serve from a secure server. Register all three certificates and keys above. Import the MQTT server client and the MQTT client required to create our MQTT client. Create an MQTT client object. The endpoint address is entered first and then the client ID is entered. The client ID receives input from the user, so I put the empty string in for now. The client security context uses the context created above. You can check various logs by logging on. If you intend to use a keep alive, you must set it here, otherwise keep alive will be disabled. The port is 8883 by default and secure connection. As a callback function for unconnected, undisconnected, and pong, I will update the status of each when the connection is successful and disconnected. Set the client's default settings, where the ID entered from the user becomes the client ID. Start the connection. If there is a problem, return false and it won't proceed further. If the connection is successful, subscribe to the predefined topic with QS0, which is at most once, and return true. This is all for the MQTT connect function. Now we will implement the connection button and disconnect button. There may be a time to wait for response from the server when the user presses the connect button. I think it'll be good if the dialog appears on the screen at this time. I will implement it easily using a dialog library available on all platforms. Add it to popspec.yaml and run popget to be ready for use. I will import end dialog first. Allows a function called underbar connect to be invoked when the icon button in the text form field is pressed. Similarly, when the disconnect button is pressed, a function called underbar disconnect is called. Need to check that the MQTT client ID user entered is empty and proceed with the connection if not. After that, let the progress dialog appear. Let's take an example of the progress dialog from the example page and use it. Most importantly, the dismiss option is forced to prevent users from forcibly removing the pop-up. This allows the user to wait when a pop-up appears on the screen while connecting. Let's add the required text. You remember that we made a variable called isConnected. If the MQTT client is connected without any problems, this will be true. Also, since it works asynchronously, the keyword async must be followed after this function name. When the connection status is confirmed, dismiss the progress dialog. I will test the connection later and check if the pop-up comes up properly first. Enter any text and click the icon to get a pop-up. There is nothing more we can do because there is no way to dismiss it. Let's go back and complete the source code. If the disconnect button is pressed, disconnect the client. It's very clear that the connection is broken here if the disconnect callback function is invoked. I will make isConnected false here. I think I'm almost done. I'm reviewing it again and all looks good. Now I build it and check it out. I'm entering the client ID and click the icon. There is a pop-up, but it's not going on anymore. What's going on here? In the console log, there seems to be a problem with the socket connection permission at the OS level. This is a problem that occurs because macOS applications work on the sandbox. To fix this problem, you can add a key to the entitlement so that you can make an external connection. select the macOS on the left, go to the runner folder. Open the debug profile entitlement. After you add it as above, you can make a connection to the outside. This is a way to fix it. Let me build it and try again. Entering client ID. The pop-up disappeared quickly because the connection was fast. The status text below shows that the connection is successful. I checked that it's connected to the MQTT broker. And the last step is that the image appears normally to the right of the body layout. Go to the body widget. Let's divide the body widget into two functions, body menu and body stream. Body menu is responsible for user input, and body stream allows the client to receive the contents of the subscribed topics. Let's complete the body stream. The client's data comes through the stream, so data must be handled using a listener or stream builder. The stream builder allows you to update the UI without the set state function. So if you need to update UI with data from a stream, I recommend you to use the stream builder. If your data doesn't need to update UI, then the listener is good. Let me show you how to use it. The stream is the client's update. In the stream builder, two parameters are included. Context and snapshot. The snapshot has a real data. If there is no data in the snapshot, return the circle progress indicator. The reason why UI objects can be returned inside the stream builder is that it has a context. If it has a data, you need to change it to the same format as sending it. If the sender sends JSON data, you need to change it to JSON format. I need to change the payload of the received message to an image because the JPEG images are incoming. There's a very useful library called image. This library can decode or encode images in a particular format and includes a variety of features. I will use this to change the data in the payload to an image. The image library cannot be used as it is because the class image already exists in Dart. In this case, you can access this library with a new name using the keyword as. The message in payload is byte data, so it's necessary to decode it in JPEG first. Since it's decoded with JPEG, it's image data from now on. If you need any modification of the image, you can do it here. Let me print out the resolution of the image. Because the ESP webcam set to VGA resolution, it should be 640 by 480. Finally, use the image widget to display the JPEG image on the screen. The gapless playback option must be true so that there is no flickering between the image and the image. This completes the body stream. Don't forget to go to the body and add the body stream instead of the container. Let me increase the body's right screen ratio a little bit more. I will rebuild and test it. It's connected to the MQTT broker and subscribed to the specific topic. You can see the image data posted on the topic in an application that you created yourself. It's working very well, and byte data is quickly being output from the console. You can see that the resolution of the image is 640 by 480. I will change the color of the body menu on the left to red black to make it easier to distinguish. Let me check it again. This is the application layout I wanted. Looks good. I will improve the layout a little more. I want this application to work on mobile as well as desktop. All the libraries we have used so far work on mobile, so no doubt they will work the same on iOS and Android. But I think the layout needs to be modified a little bit. Since the width of the mobile is shorter than the desktop, it will be better to put the body menu up. Let me go back to the code and make some corrections. First, let's set the header text always in the center. the length of the screen can be determined through the media query. If the horizontal length of the screen is less than 600 pixels, I will change the body part up and down, not left and right. If you look at the current body, it's divided into rows. All you have to do is change this to column when it has a short length. In column, the body menu is drawn to that size, and the body stream is drawn to the maximum screen, so I used expanded for this. The flex option is not required here. Don't forget to hand over the variable. I will label this and check. If I adjust the horizontal length of the screen to 600 pixels or less, I can see the menu moves to the top. It works well. It has no effect on the function because it's just a rail adjustment. Now I will try to build on iOS. On the target device, select Open iOS Simulator to open one iOS simulator. I will build it right away without any code modification. Oops, I didn't select the target device with the iOS simulator. I will try it after selecting it again. It was built without any problems, but there is a problem with one layout. I think the top and bottom parts are being cut off. This can be solved simply by using a widget called Safe Area. Let's fix it right away. Let's start with the client ID. You can see that it works the same as the Mac application. In landscape mode, the horizontal length is longer, so you can see the menu move to the right. Lastly, I will try to show it on Android. I will start the Android emulator and build for it. It's very slow on Android emulator. It's not this slow if we put it on actual device. This completes the Mqtt client application that works on macOS, iOS, and Android. Personally, I think Flutter has a potential power because it's an ever-evolving platform, and it'll be good to be interested if you're a front-end or mobile developer. That's all for today's video. Thanks for watching. See you on the next project.